Hello and welcome to the James Bond Countdown. I've been expecting you. Yes, after much delay, this is the official debut, the inaugural countdown of the series where I, a lifelong 007 fan, bring you ranked lists pertaining to every last aspect of the James Bond film franchise. This is a passion project that I have been planning for quite some time. I've also been pushing it off for quite some time, but that's only because I wanted to wait until No Time to Die was released so that I could factor it into all of my lists. The first of which is a big one. As a matter of fact, it's the big one. That's right. I am starting with my ranking of all the official Bond films, and I really debated on when to do this one because it's the quintessential list that any Bond fan can have. At first I thought maybe I should save it and build up to it, especially because I knew it would be a long video. But then I thought, what better way to introduce myself as a Bond fan? I'm pretty sure any time two Bond fans meet, the conversation inevitably turns to how they rank the films. It's the perfect list to represent what kind of a Bond fan I am, which actors and eras I gravitate towards, and which ones I'd rather keep locked up in the box set. In no other franchise does personal preference play such a large part. This series has gone in so many different directions over such a long period of time, which is why no two fans ever have the exact same ranking of every film. On that note, I'm going to give a bit of a disclaimer that I'm probably going to have a few unpopular opinions on this list. There are a handful of films that most Bond fans really love, and I really don't. Just the same, there are a few notoriously maligned films that I absolutely adore. So, before you start berating me in the comments, please remember that everything is subjective, especially when it comes to Bond. Without any more delay, let the mayhem begin. This is a complete countdown. Speaking of unpopular opinions, I am placing On Her Majesty's Secret Service at the very bottom of my list. Yes, George Lazenby's one and only Bond outing also happens to be my least favorite. For the life of me, I cannot understand why this film is so loved. Especially because I feel like there was a time when mine was the popular opinion. But then somewhere in the last 20 years, the movie gained this underdog reputation of being the most overlooked and underrated Bond film. Now, I was introduced to Bond via my father, who hated both Lazenby and this movie, so one might think that I was never given the chance to like Majesties, but I recently rewatched it with an open mind, and I guess I'm just my father's son. Aside from John Barry, Diana Rigg, and a couple of the action sequences, nothing about this movie works for me. My biggest problem is Lazenby. I find his performance flat, stiff, boring, soulless, and arrogant, but he's not my only problem. The story is contrived and poorly executed, the pacing is mind-numbingly slow, the editing is unwatchable at times, the dubbing is laughable.
Tactfully adjusted to favor me.
And I do not buy into the love story. Seriously, we're given the length of a 3-minute montage to believe Bond and Tracy have fallen in love. Oh, and don't even get me started on how this movie single-handedly derailed the continuity established in the previous 5 films.
This never happened to the other fella.
Next on my list is one that I feel a little less alone on. In all fairness, Moonraker does have its defenders, but I think it generally ranks pretty low for most Bond fans, myself included. It's just too fantastical and too farcical, plain and simple. Bond is a very reactionary franchise. Each film is a direct response to how the previous one was received. Spy Who Loved Me was a massive success, so they simply repeated the exact same formula and then doubled down on the most popular elements, namely the scale and the humor. But the result is a poor imitation of its predecessor. It goes too big and too campy. Don't get me wrong, I love the campiness of the Roger Moore era, but in moderation. There needs to be a balance so you can have a few laughs and still take the movie seriously. But this movie doesn't take itself seriously. All the characters feel like the poor man's version of their counterparts from the previous movie, including Jaws, who manages to be a poor man's version of himself from the previous movie. As far as I'm concerned, this may as well be a parody by Mel Brooks. It's certainly Austin Powers before Austin Powers, and with a little help from the end credits of Spy Who Loved Me, I can pretend that it never happened. Bouncing right back to another unpopular opinion, I am making the dangerous claim that Live and Let Die is completely and utterly mediocre. This is another movie that I cannot understand the love for. It is James Bond meets 1970s blaxploitation, and that has sealed its fate, I think, as the Bond film that has aged the worst. Exhibit A.
My name is James is for tombstones, baby. Y'all take this honky out and waste him, now!
I rest my case. But blaxploitation aside, I also find it very dull. Bond doesn't feel like an active participant in the story. Things are just happening to and around him everywhere he goes, and he's left scratching his head. And I'm sorry, but I can't get on board with Bond essentially faking a sign from God so he can take the virginity of a religious girl who's literally 20 years younger than he is. I'll concede that the boat chase is one of the greatest action sequences in Bond history, but aside from that, there's only a small handful of moments and characters that I enjoy. Okay, back to one that won't get me chased out of town. I don't think it will offend anyone to place Die Another Day this low on the list. This thing is a garbage fire. And it really bums me out because this was actually the first Bond film that I saw in the movie theater. I was 6 years old, and I loved it as a six-year-old, so it'll always carry a bit of nostalgia, but not enough to save it in my adult eyes. I give credit to Brosnan for how comfortable and confident he is in the role here, but there was only so much he could do to stay grounded in a movie that was so bonkers. And it's a shame because the basic premise at the start of this movie is such a good idea. In the middle of a mission, James Bond is sold out by a mole inside MI6, spends 14 months being tortured in a North Korean prison, then gets out and goes after the person who set him up. That is a great idea for a Bond movie. But then you have a spontaneous sword fight, an invisible car, a diamond satellite that shoots a giant laser beam, a villain who undergoes the most unbelievable plastic surgery in film history, and Moneypenny's VR sex fantasy. Oh, and of course, kitesurfing a tsunami. And yes, as bad as it is, I still find it more entertaining to watch than the previous films I mentioned. At this point, I'm realizing just how much the bottom of my list flip-flops for and against popular opinion, because next on the chopping block is Thunderball. This, in my mind, is probably the most overrated Bond film of them all. On paper, it should be the perfect Bond film. The ingredients are all there, but the execution is just so damn boring. Even outside the drag of the underwater scenes, the pacing in this movie is horrendous. You've got 40 minutes of Bond dicking around at a health spa before he even gets his mission, and it's an hour and a half before Bond knows everything that the audience has learned in the first 20 minutes. There's just so much meandering in this movie. Considering the stakes of the mission, you'd think there would be a sense of urgency in the air, but everybody's just hanging out in the Bahamas pretending that they don't know their enemies. I recently showed this movie to a friend who had never seen it before, and he commented on how frequently he forgot that Bond was even supposed to be looking for a pair of A-bombs. The only reason it places this highly on the list is because of how visually stunning it is and how absolutely electrifying Fiona Volpe is.
Do you like wild things, Mr. Bond, James Bond?
Alright, I think I should be out of contentious territory for a little while, because now we are moving from bottom of the barrel to middle of the road. For my money, You Only Live Twice is a Bond movie best described as aggressively average. The script is messy, at best, and Connery doesn't do it any favors by being so blatantly bored of being Bond. But still, the movie manages to be easier to sit through than its predecessor, although if I'm being honest, that's probably just because it's not as long. Setting aside specific elements that are iconic and just thinking about the movie as a whole, I don't have any strong criticisms against it, but I also don't have any strong praises for it, which is probably why it lands where it does on my list. I just don't care about this movie. As a matter of fact, if it weren't for Blofeld and the volcano lair, I think this would probably be regarded as the most forgettable Bond movie of them all. And that's probably for the best, because no one needs to remember the sequence where Bond goes undercover. In my opinion, For Your Eyes Only is probably the single greatest waste of potential in the Bond series. This should have been the film that launched Timothy Dalton as James Bond, setting him up to own the 80s in the same way that Connery owned the 60s and Moore owned the 70s. Thinking about this movie as a follow-up to Moonraker, almost everything about it feels like it was engineered to introduce a new actor, from the obvious tonal shift to the way the camera reveals Bond in the pre-title sequence. And I love how Dalton is introduced in The Living Daylights, but this would have been even better. Bond finally avenging his wife's death, and the story's general themes of revenge, would have been a beautiful bookend with License to Kill, establishing Dalton as the vengeful Bond. That being said, even with Dalton, this probably still wouldn't be one of my favorites. I like Molina and Columbo, but the villains have no personality whatsoever, and while I respect the whole Cold War espionage thing, the story admittedly isn't all that exciting. If Dalton had been in the movie, I could at least look back at it for some deadly moments of conviction from a more dangerous Bond, but as a Roger Moore film, it just feels lackluster. It doesn't play to any of his strengths. He does a serviceable job with the more serious moments, but Dalton would have absolutely chewed it up. In spite of how low it is on my list, I've actually been a big defender of Quantum of Solace for a long time. Craig brought his A-game to this movie. Sure, the script had him doing and saying a few things that didn't make much sense, but I don't fault him for that. He still delivers his trademark range of emotional complexity and ruthless danger that his predecessors mostly lacked. He also has a morbid humor about him in this movie that nobody seems to appreciate.
I promised them the sheaf and they got the sheaf.
They got his body.
They'd wanted his soul, they should have made a deal with a priest.
I like most of the action, and Camille and Felix are both great. I love their relationships with Bond. But overall, the movie is undeniably underwhelming, as are the villains, as is their evil scheme. I appreciate them going for grounded, but they could have done something a little flashier and still been grounded. And the revenge subplot isn't explored nearly as deeply as it should have been. Come to think of it, I really don't understand how it got relegated to the B story. Bond following the trail to avenge Vesper should have been the main plot of this movie. It could have been License to Kill 2.0. But Quantum's greatest sin is that it didn't fulfill the promise of Casino Royale's ending, that Bond was fully formed and ready for a classic mission. For me, The Living Daylights is the Bond film that I want so badly to love, but I just don't. I love Dalton in it, but the movie itself just falls flat for me. Similar to For Your Eyes Only, it's admirable that they were going for a Cold War espionage story, but the execution of it is not the least bit exciting. If you're going to do a stripped-back spy story, you have to do it as a thriller, substituting action for suspense. This should have been approached like a Hitchcock film. Twists, turns, and tension building as Bond unravels a conspiracy. But that's not how they approached it. Structurally, it feels tired and lazy, following the beats of the old Roger Moore formula. And boy, does the second act drag. Unfortunately, the characters are equally mundane. Koskov, in my opinion, is the weakest villain of the whole series, and Kara is a fine love interest. I like that they made her integral to the plot, but I've always found her to be kind of sleepy, for lack of a better word. Which actually isn't a bad way to describe this whole movie. There are a couple of great action sequences, but not enough to bring up the pace of this thing. Truthfully, the only reason it ranks this highly for me is Dalton. His danger, his conviction, and as he always put it, his reality, are always compelling to watch, even when the movie is a bore. Rounding out what I categorize as the bland bunch is none other than Spectre. Yes, I do give Spectre the edge on Quantum, simply because it's a better constructed movie with a more fully realized story, even if I don't like what that story has to say. But similar to how Quantum failed to fulfill Casino's promise, Spectre failed to fulfill Skyfall's promise. The ending of that movie was so beautiful because you literally could have gone in any direction after that. The possibilities were endless. And then they wrote themselves into a corner. Which is why I think getting the rights back for Blofeld and Spectre was the worst thing that could have happened to them creatively. From the moment the movie was announced, I knew they would try to retroactively connect the events of all of Craig's previous films and say that Blofeld was behind all of it. And it simply doesn't work when you try to connect the dots after the fact. You need to have been planting the seeds for that all along. Maybe I could forgive the messiness of a forced continuity if the movie was a fun ride, but it's so drab. I never expected to be bored during a Craig film. All the performances are way too understated. No one has any life, color, or energy, and neither do the visuals. I like enough of the action and quiet character moments for the film to place this highly on my list, but I'll never argue with anyone who places it lower on theirs. Alright, now we can start having fun, because we have arrived at Octopussy. This is another one that I think would have been better as a Dalton film, however, unlike For Your Eyes Only, I do think that it works as a Roger Moore outing. It has the Cold War elements again, but they've injected just enough humor into the script for Moore to be able to do his thing. Though in spite of the occasional gag, you can still take it seriously. It has an interesting story with a good sense of stakes, a strong love interest who has a compelling relationship with Bond, and certainly a much better ensemble of villains than its predecessor. So why doesn't this movie place higher on my list? Well, it does get a little slow for me at points. I'm not crazy about India as a setting, and the action suffers from how much Moore seems to be struggling with it. He just looks too old and awkward to make me believe the danger, which is actually a complaint I hold with all three of his 80s outings. Just picture Dalton in the train sequence. He would have elevated the action to a whole nother level. He also would have elevated the drama. Moore does a fine job with the scenes where Bond confronts Orlov and Grishka, but once again Dalton would have played it with a conviction that simply wasn't in Moore's range. I know I'm gonna catch a lot of flack for this one, and I do not care. Diamonds Are Forever is just so much damn fun, and it's been a favorite ever since I was a kid. Should it have been a dark and serious revenge tale about Bond hunting down his wife's killers? Yes, absolutely. And maybe that would bother me more if I were a fan of On Her Majesty's Secret Service, but I'm not, so I enjoy the nonsense. Give me that moon buggy chase, and give me that cross-dressing Blofeld. Speaking of which, I will say that Charles Grey does not work for me as Blofeld, but what does work for me is Winton Kidd. Creepy, kooky, and morbidly funny, I can't get enough of him.
If God had wanted man to fly,
he would have given him wings, Mr. Kidd.
But the thing that I love most about this movie is the man himself. Connery looks like he's actually having fun playing James Bond again. He looked so over it in You Only Live Twice, and to a lesser extent in Thunderball, and this feels like he's back and loving it. He's not playing it as seriously as he did in the early movies, he's definitely bringing the camp here, but I still buy him in the action, even if he was starting to rock a dad bod. Like I said, I enjoy camp in moderation, though I actually wouldn't call Diamond straight up campy, just charmingly offbeat.
Thank you very much. I was just out walking my rat and I seem to have lost my way.
This is another one I'm gonna get a lot of heat for, but I will never apologize for my love of A View to a Kill. And I mean love. This is not a guilty pleasure. I absolutely, unabashedly, unironically adore this movie. It is weird and wacky and wonderful. Yes, Roger Moore is absurdly old, and yes, that makes most of his action scenes laughable, and it certainly makes for the creepiest, cringiest love scenes in the whole series. But even though I can't take him seriously, I can take the story seriously, and I can take just about all the other characters seriously. Stacy isn't great, but this has one of the best villain ensembles in Bond history, led by the delightfully psychotic Max Zorin. Christopher Walken is far and away the best thing in the movie, equal parts strange and scary. And I actually think this is the best paced of Roger Moore's Bond films. There are even points in the couple that I rank above this one where I'll tend to zone out, but A View to a Kill never loses my attention. It's a great ride. I will say, as much as I love this movie, I would still rather have an overhauled, starkly serious version of it starring Dalton. It would undeniably be a top 5 Bond film, and thinking about Dalton versus Walken atop the Golden Gate Bridge gives me chills. Tomorrow Never Dies has been a favorite of mine ever since I was a kid. It's easily one of the Bond films I've seen the most. It's just so watchable. I always like to describe it as the perfect paint-by-numbers Bond film. Like if you were to ask an AI program to make a Bond film, I think this is what it would do. And I say that as both a strength and a weakness for the movie. It's a strength because it perfectly checks all the boxes of the classic Bond formula and executes it in a well-paced, entertaining adventure, but it's a weakness because it doesn't really have any unique depth or dimension about it. Even Brosnan feels like a superficial version of James Bond. He looks, walks, and talks like James Bond, but there's nothing dynamic about his performance. That said, the action is fantastic and I have no issues with any of the characters or the story. Jonathan Pryce in particular is delightfully deranged as Elliot Carver. I always have a good time watching this movie. I just don't get anything profound out of it. It's like a really good scoop of vanilla ice cream. The World Is Not Enough is one that I struggle with. I think this is a good Bond film that had the potential to be a great Bond film if they just tweaked a few things. The story is solid, as is the big twist. Sophie Marceau does a beautiful job of playing both Wounded Dove and Femme Fatale. It also has great action all around, namely one of the best pre-title sequences in the whole franchise. I do wish it explored the relationship between Bond and Elektra more deeply, but the big thing that hinders this movie from being something greater than what it is has got to be Denise Richards as Christmas Jones. She just sticks out like a sore thumb in this movie. She's a poorly written character to begin with, and casting her only made it worse. You can take almost everything else seriously, but you're pulled straight out of it whenever you see or hear her. She carries no weight in her delivery of the overly serious dialogue that she's given.
Are you gonna do what I think you're gonna do?
What do I need to defuse a nuclear bomb?
Me.
And this is going to sound strange to say, but even if she were a better actress, she's just too attractive for this role. It's a nuclear physicist who looks like a supermodel. It's downright distracting, and it bumps the film down to be almost equal with Tomorrow Never Dies for me. But the thing that gives it a slight edge is Brosnan's performance. He was clearly going for something with a harder edge here, and I really wish the script gave him more opportunities to go down that road. To be perfectly honest, I think it's still a bit too early to rank No Time to Die, but I'm gonna do it anyway because I feel like this will always be a hard one for me to place, regardless of how much time has gone by. Starting with the positives, Cary Fukunaga directed the hell out of this movie. It's beautiful to look at, the action is exhilarating, and the relationships between the characters make up for most of the story's plot holes. From the pre-title sequence up through the Cuban nightclub, this thing is a colorful, fast-paced, fun-filled James Bond thriller on par with the best of the series. But the movie gets really uneven for me, starting with Felix's death. The way he goes out just feels so abrupt and unceremonious. Jeffrey Wright deserved better, as did Rami Malek. Safin is creepy, but his motivations beyond killing Spectre are so ill-defined, and he just doesn't have enough of a presence throughout the entire movie. On a thematic note, I think the use of All the Time in the World is admirable, though ultimately misplaced because it holds no meaning for Craig's version of the character. But the real reason this movie doesn't rank higher for me is the third act. From the moment we learn about Bond's daughter onwards, it doesn't quite feel like a Bond movie anymore, simply because she adds an element to the story that isn't comparable to any of the films that came before it. Bond starts acting differently when he learns about Mathilde, and we have no frame of reference for Bond acting that way, so it inherently feels out of character, as does his decision to die. It would be one thing if Bond were sacrificing himself to save the world, but that's not what happened. The day was saved, and he chose to die for fear of infecting his family. But James Bond is a character who does not quit. Ever. And I feel like he would spend the rest of his life trying to find a cure before he would just give up and die. In short, No Time to Die places this highly for me because it has excellent action and strong performances from start to finish, but I wouldn't place it any higher than this because the script makes some big choices that are just never gonna sit right with me. Similar to Tomorrow Never Dies and The World Is Not Enough, my next couple entries are also neck and neck, the first of which being Dr. No. This is a movie that I continually grow to appreciate as I get older, and I tend to enjoy more each time I see it. It's just so simple and stripped back. Because it's the first Bond film, it almost doesn't feel like a Bond film. Certain elements were there, but they weren't fully formed yet, so it mostly just feels like another film of its day. And I say that in the best possible way. It has a quietness about it that's very evocative of films from the 1950s and early 60s. There's action here and there, but it's about people. People who are talking and investigating, and there's an interesting mystery at the center of it all. It almost feels more like a detective story than a spy story, which is actually how I describe most of the Fleming books. The supporting cast is great, allies and enemies alike. Dr. No himself makes such a big impact in spite of having so little screen time.
Unfortunately, I misjudged you. You are just a stupid policeman.
And of course, there's Connery. His performance in this film is so pitch perfect, from the way he introduces himself to the way he kills in cold blood. He was born to be Bond.
I'm flattered.
Neck and neck with Dr. No is none other than From Russia with Love. I give it a slight edge because it does have a more interesting and intricately woven plot, and a lot more thrills. The train fight between Bond and Grant is the gold standard by which all Bond fight scenes are measured. It's unbelievable how far ahead of its time it was. This thing still holds up against any modern fight scene. There's nothing about it that looks the slightest bit dated, other than maybe the extreme close-ups, but even that is something I could see being done in some fashion today. I love the version of Blofeld that this movie uses. I don't think he's ever worked better than he did in this movie, and to a briefer extent in Thunderball. Connery takes the foundation that he laid in Dr. No and builds every character trait nearly to full form, from suave to sophisticated to dangerous. And John Barry introduces the distinctive Bond sound into the score after Dr. No's generic 60s sound. There's really not much I can say about From Russia with Love that hasn't been said a million times. It is quintessential Bond. If I have one gripe, it would have to be that realizing how much this movie is clearly emulating Hitchcock just makes me think about how it would have been even better if Hitchcock had actually directed it. Now we arrive at something of a hot-button issue for me. I truly cannot understand why The Man with the Golden Gun is so widely disliked. I've always felt that this and Spy Who Loved Me are easily Roger's two best Bond films, well above his others. This is another one that I've loved since I was little, but looking at it as unbiased as I possibly can, I still feel that it's one of the most criminally underrated 007 movies of all time. The villain, his henchmen, and their lair are all as excellent as they are iconic, the action is fun and inventive, and even the ladies, who admittedly aren't the strongest of the series, both have really good chemistry with Roger. I love me some Sheriff J.W. Pepper, and the dialogue between Bond and Scaramanga gives me chills.
To us, Mr. Bond, we are the best.
But the thing that always surprises me about this movie is how physical Roger Moore is. As a matter of fact, I think this is the most involved and active he is in the action of any of his movies. There was plenty of action in Live and Let Die, but it was mostly him driving various vehicles. Here he's running and jumping and fighting, and I believe it. I actually buy Roger Moore kicking ass in this movie. He pulls off tough really well, particularly in the fight with the Beirut thugs where he's getting sweaty and bloody. Well, I now join many a Bond fan before me in declaring The Spy Who Loved Me the unequivocal best Roger Moore film. It has the absolute perfect amount of campiness to be able to laugh along without rolling your eyes, and it easily features the strongest performance of Moore's tenure. He has total ownership of the role, and the script plays to all of his strengths, consistently teeing him up to hit home runs. The action is exhilarating, full of cleverly timed gags that elevate it rather than undercut it.
All those feathers and he still can't fly.
And in my opinion, the ski jump remains unmatched in the history of Bond stunts. People frequently cite both Stromberg and Anya as weak points of the film, but I think they're both perfect for what the story needs of them. If I have one complaint, it's that the final battle inside the tanker drags on too long, but that can be said of pretty much every third act battle sequence in Bond history. This is actually one of two Bond films that I had in my top three for a very long time, but when I was recently re-evaluating my list, I realized that I had them there in an obligatory capacity. I kept them in the top three because I felt that I had to, so I got honest with myself and admitted that there are a few I enjoy more and would frankly rather watch on a given day. That being said, The Spy Who Loved Me is every bit a quintessential classic, and I have no love lost for it whatsoever. And now on to the other film that I formerly felt obligated to keep in my top three, Goldfinger. This is the film that perfected and cemented the Bond formula. It's all there. Every trope, every trapping, every last bit of iconography that the series still emulates to this day. I always like to say that Dr. No set the standard for a good Bond movie, From Russia with Love set the standard for a great Bond movie, and Goldfinger set the standard for a perfect Bond movie. The action by and large surpasses that of the two previous films, offering the first real car chase of the series, and the story is timeless. It doesn't concern itself with making any social or political statements about what was going on at the time. There's no historical context to be lost on a modern audience. Goldfinger and Oddjob both deserve their obligatory spots atop all the best of Bond lists. So many villains and henchmen were molded after their blueprints, but no one ever did it quite as well as they did. And Honor Blackman rises above the absurdity of her character's name to create a powerful presence that can match Connery's confidence.
My name is Pussy Galore.
I must be dreaming.
Speaking of which, Connery was never better as Bond than he is in this movie. Plain and simple. He is James Bond here, as much as any actor ever has been or ever could be. License to Kill is without a doubt the Bond film that I feel most passionately about. This, in my mind, deserves the love and recognition that On Her Majesty's Secret Service has gotten in recent years. It is by far the most overlooked and underrated James Bond film of all time. I love how it throws away the formula in favor of doing a far more straightforward story that masterfully captures the resourceful side of Bond. He doesn't always fight his way out of a tough spot, sometimes he has to think his way out, and it's brilliant how he infiltrates Sanchez's organization to dismantle it from the inside. Speaking of Sanchez, I would argue that he is the scariest, most realistic villain in the history of the franchise, and he has such a sleazy band of henchmen backing him up.
I want you to know this is nothing personal. It's purely business.
But the highlight of the movie is easily the man, Timothy Dalton. Never has an actor better captured the ruthless, vengeful, all-around cold-blooded side of Bond than he does in this movie. The conviction in his performance is endlessly compelling. Every look, every line, it all carries such a dramatic weight. And I love how he responds to finally killing Sanchez. It's not this celebratory moment where he makes a pun about how the villain died. He's absolutely destroyed by the emotional toll that this vendetta has taken on him. It was a boldly mature moment for the series at this point in time. In much the same way that I love how stripped back License to Kill is, I love how GoldenEye is firing on all cylinders. From the opening stunt to the globetrotting adventure to Moneypenny and M, Q, and the gadgets, and hands down the strongest villain ensemble in the whole series, this is a Bond movie with a capital B. And that B may as well stand for Brosnan too, because boy does he bring it. He had wanted the part so badly for so long, and he owned it as if he'd already had it for years. He's just so comfortable and confident here. There are no tonal or structural holdovers from the previous actor like there had been for Dalton and Moore when they first took over. GoldenEye made the Bond formula feel fresh again. It presented all the tropes as if we were seeing them for the first time. It's such a thoroughly plotted story with masterfully executed action and dynamically constructed relationships. The history between 007 and 006 in particular is such an ingenious approach to a Bond and villain relationship. And Natalia is a refreshingly complex character compared to the average love interest fans had come to expect at this point. This will always be a top five for me.
We aim to please.
I've always described Skyfall as the ultimate blend of modern Bond and classic Bond. It found the perfect measure of old-school elements to sprinkle into the world and tone established in Casino Royale. Not only that, but you learn more about Bond in this one movie than you do in all of the others put together. The relationship between Bond and M at the heart of this film is so moving. The action sequences are among my all-time favorites, especially the pre-title sequence, and what Javier Bardem achieved with Silva is nothing short of miraculous. Here is a larger-than-life, out-of-his-mind villain who somehow manages to feel like a real human being. I will say that I wish Severine had been used as a classic femme fatale in the spirit of Fiona or Xenia. She has such a marvelous screen presence when she's playing sultry and sinister in the casino. From the time it came out until about a year ago, I actually held Skyfall at my number one spot. And I genuinely regarded it as such when I first saw it. But then over the years, I sort of just kept saying it was my favorite without checking in with myself to see if I still really felt that way. So around the same time I reevaluated my ranks of Goldfinger and Spy Who Loved Me, I got honest with myself about what my all-time favorite Bond movie is, and Skyfall got edged out. I hate to be predictable, but I have to be honest with myself. Casino Royale is my number one all-time favorite Bond movie, and I think it has been for quite a while. It's a movie that mostly went unappreciated and over my head when I was younger, but continues to show me new depths of plot and character as I get older. It has the most exciting action and intelligent dialogue the franchise has ever seen, and there will never be a better written or acted woman in a Bond film than Vesper Lynd. her relationship with Bond is so real and so vulnerable, and I believe every second of them falling in love. Le Chiffre is as perfect a villain as you can get, and of course Daniel Craig gives the best debut performance of any Bond actor. Rather than trying to appear comfortable and confident in the role as it was defined by others before him, he reinvents it completely, allowing him to take ownership of it as if he were the first actor to play James Bond. Breaking Bond down to build him back up again was the best decision this franchise ever made. It's also worth noting that removing the context of Bond just as a movie, this is nothing short of a masterpiece, and it's certainly a masterclass in action cinema. For me, it is quite simply the greatest James Bond movie that ever has been or ever will be made.
You noticed.
Well, there you have it, all 25 official Bond films ranked. Here's hoping it's the first of many lists right here on the James Bond Countdown. Please jump into the comments section below to tell me how wrong or right you think I am, and of course, share your own rankings. I really want this to be a place where the Bond community can congregate and, well, bond. So definitely subscribe to make sure you never miss a countdown.